thing that we are speaking here at Faith Worship Center. It said this 2019 is the year of what? Great with what? Great. The year of great what? Great expectation. Am I saying it right? Y'all say it with me now. Yeah, great expectation. And then it says the year of our God is what? In his kingdom. With great expectation. Without what? Without what? Without fear. So I'm going to stay on that because the Lord is leading me. That's what he put in my spirit, to stay on that. And we're talking about love and relationship on Wednesdays and Sundays. Love and relationship. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And because he gave us the love and he loved us, we love him. And in the workshop, in the teaching during the weeks and on Sundays, we got to love one another. Relationship. I can't make it without you, and you can't make it without me. You can't have unity and do the work of the Lord unless we what? Work together. So we're going to stay there. And I'm going to read these scriptures here. Our proclamation and declaration is, remember the former things of old, for I am God and there's none else like me. Let me put my timer on. I want to stay within what obedience, what they tell us. Thank you, Jesus. All right, and then it says, there's none like me. Remember, God doesn't want us to forget. The Lord doesn't want us to forget. So he said, remember the former things, what I did in the past. Yes, remember it, because there is none else. There's no one like me. Nobody can do it like me. God can show up and show out. Then it says, declare the end from the beginning. Who can do that? Who can tell you how it ends before you start doing it? He said, I know the end before you the beginning. Yes, Lord, because of anxious time, the things that are not yet done, he can tell us. And he's speaking to our leaders, telling us what is going to happen, what he wants us to do. My counsel shall stand, and I will do my pleasure. You know what pleasure is? The things that you like to do. Well, God is saying he's going to do his pleasure, and we're going to give him credit for it. We're going to praise his name. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. That is at the declaration that I'm going to go over here and read to you. It's the word. The Lord told me to speak the word. I don't know about you. Oh, we got to speak the what? Speak the word. Focus on the same thing. Now, in John, the fourth chapter, we're going to be looking at verses 7 through 13. Verses 7 through 13, it says, beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten son into the world that we might live through him. Hallelujah. Herein is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to also love one another. No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his spirit. And we're going to skip on that same chapter, and we're going to look at verse 18. There is no fear. Can we say that? There is no fear in love. Let's say it again. There is no fear in love. Because love does what? Cast out all fear. What I should put all in this is cast it out fear. So if it casts out fear, all is gone, isn't it? Because fear has what? Fear has torment. It's tormenting you, telling you someone doesn't love you. They don't love you. They don't love you. And the devil keeps on speaking. You keep on listening to it. It's going to torment you. If you know God loves you, don't worry about it if somebody else doesn't love you. Hallelujah. We're going to get through this. We're going to get through this. And the rest of that verse is that he that feareth is not made perfect in love. Let us pray. Oh, Father God, we're going to stand on your word, holy God, Jesus, yes. You told us in your word to have no fear, no fear, no fear, no fear, no fear, no fear. Because you told us that, we're going to tell you we love you, Lord. Lord, we love you. We love you. We love you because you got our backs. You got our backs. You're teaching us, God, in your word, what you want us to do. Because fear is not going to work through faith. So if we don't have any fear, we're going to have faith. Faith is what pleased God. And now faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence is that we don't see it, but we believe and we hope for. We'll have what God says in his word. We thank you, Lord. We have no fear. We have no fear. We thank you, God, for you loving us. No fear of death. No fear of sickness. No fear of financial stress. Yes, Lord. No fear, no fear, no fear. No fear, no fear. Yes, Lord, we're going to stand on it, God. We're going to stand on it. We thank you, God, for how you are healing us. We see you send forth your healing power in Jesus' name. And we're going to stand on your word, God. Stand on your word, God. Stand on your word, God. Yes, Lord. We love you, God. We love you, God. We love you, God. Move through this place, God, today. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, for who you are. We thank you for who you are, not for what you can do for us, but who you are. There's none like you. Oh, you got all power in your hand to do what you want to do. And we thank you, God. Move in this place, God. Move in this place. Now, you ask us when we come to the throne of grace boldly. We're not ashamed to come to the throne of God boldly to ask and make our requests known unto you. Because you said in your word that you will hearken to our voice if our hearts are right. You said, ask any good thing according to your word, and it is ours. And then, Lord, you told us when we come to the altar and put our sins there, that you will forgive us. And when we ask that you forgive us, you're just God. You will forgive us. Because a heart that is filled with envy, strife, and jealousy, you're not going to answer us. So therefore, God, we know we have not done all that we should have done this week and even this morning. So forgive us, God. Forgive us, because we want our prayers to be answered. We don't want you to pray, want you to show a deaf ear to our prayers. Yes, Lord, because you said in some part in the word that you'll show a deaf ear to our prayers if we don't live and ask forgiveness. So we thank you, because you're just to forgive us for our sin. Grace and mercy, we need it, Lord. Grace and mercy, pour it down on us, God. Because we don't have all we need to do the work that you want us to do in the kingdom. Fill us with your Holy Ghost, God. Fill us, God. Fill us, God. You can fill us some more. Fill us some more. Fill us some more. Fill us some more, Lord. Fill us some more. Fill us some more with your power and grace. Send forth your fruit of the Spirit in us. Send forth your gifts of the Spirit in us. Manifest them, God, the way you want to do it, so we can do the work of the kingdom. Continue to anoint us with your Holy Ghost power, with fire, with fire, with a burning fire, with a burning fire, God. Yes, Lord, the fire and the Holy Ghost. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. We thank you, God, for what you're doing, what you're going to do, and what you have done. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Only you could do it, God. We love you. We love you, God. We love you. We love you, God. You said if we love you, we would keep your commandments. And it's not grievous. It is not grievous. What makes it grievous if we don't want to do it? Anything we want to do is easy. It is easy. When we want to please you, Lord, it's our desire to please you. Give us the strength, God, and enable us, God. Enable us to humble ourselves. Enable us and give us the desire to humble ourselves according to your will. Your will, Lord, does not give us, it does not give us sorrow. It does not give us sorrow. Your will does not give us sorrow. It says the blessings of the Lord make us rich and add no sorrow. So we want your blessings, God, and your blessing is in your will. That's why we are praying your will, God, be done in us as it is being done in heaven. Lord, we love you. We love you, God. 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 Love hides a multitude of faults. Love hides a multitude of faults. We have each other's back, God, through love and relationships. Help us, Lord, through these weeks that we are going through to learn more about your love for us and our love for one another. We got to love one another. You said, how can we love one another? How can we love God and we don't love one another? It says you're a liar and the truth is not in you. Help us to love like you, God. If you don't do it, it can't be done. We thank you, God. We thank you. Now we're gonna do warfare and let the devil know that we know no weapon that is formed against us will prosper. No weapon that is formed will prosper. It may be formed, but it's not going to have the effect that it started out to do when it was formed. God will give us the grace to withstand, because he said he will not put on us more than we can bear. And we thank you, God. We're letting the devil know we have no fear. No fear. Fear be gone. Fear be gone. Fear be gone. And faith come. Arise, faith. Arise, faith in us. Let our faith grow in us individually and collectively in the name of Jesus. The name of our church is the Oasis at Faith Worship Center. Faith Worship Center. Look at God. Look at God. Gave us the name of faith. Most powerful source in the universe besides the Holy Ghost. Because faith pleases God. We thank and we are praying for our pastors, our bishop, Bishop Thomas and Pastor Kay. Continue to anoint them, God. Anoint their ears. Anoint their eyes so they could see. And their ears that they can hear what you're saying. With clarity. With clarity. No clog in their ears. And their lips not stammering to tell us what you want to us to hear from you, God. Give them the vision, Lord. And give them the strength and enable them that this vision will be accomplished. We know it's going to be accomplished step by step, Lord. Any way you want to do it, you do your pleasure with them. Yes, Lord, keep them strong. We're praying for Faith Worship Center members and their families, and we're praying for the people who are on the airwaves and on the social media and every other form, God, that can hear what we're doing here at Faith Worship Center all around the world. Father God, we thank you for what you're doing, what you're going to do, and how you're going to do it, Lord. It's in your hand. Do what you want to do. We are praying for the members that are leaders in the church. We're praying for Minister Deborah. We're praying for Sister Hannah. We're praying for the praise team. We're praying for our chief intercessor, Sister Shelley. Yes, Lord, and all the other prayer warriors. You know their names, God. You know their names one by one. One by one, name by name. Some lay members are praying, God. Keep them strong. Keep us strong. And give us the spirit of unity. The spirit of unity is a powerful source, God. We got to stay strong together. We got to stay strong together. Yes, Lord. We want to be stronger than the people in Babel, how they worked. And God said anything they did would accomplish if he had not changed that language. Lord, you keep us one. Keep us one in the language and know that we are doing what the pastors have told us to do. That's why we're saying the year of God's kingdom, expectation, great expectation. And we're standing saying the same thing with the relationship and love. Teach us, God, help us and enable us and impact us to do what you want us to do. And in that, God, you'll be pleased. You'll be pleased. And one more thing, Lord, for the bereaved family. We are praying for the bereaved families, especially our member here at Faith Worship Center. We're going to lift up Sister Graham and the Graham family and all other people associated with the Graham family, Lord. Anybody who we don't know about, even on the waves, that our voice, they haven't bereaved and going through. Give them the strength, Lord, to go through. They can go through. You with your strength. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And this is our prayer in Jesus' name. We said amen. Amen. Thank you, God.
Hallelujah. 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 Come on and rest on your feet this morning. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Yes. is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I will rejoice and be glad in it.
freedom. He wipes every tear from my eyes. Hallelujah. He does it all for me. Hallelujah. Yes, he does. Hey, he's an architect every single day. He makes the sky different. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He can catch every one of your mood swings and bring it back into his bosom. Hallelujah. 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 Hey. My fixer. Hey. My regulator. My God. That is who you are. That is who you are. He regulates my mind. He saturates my heart. He moves things out of my way. I am a moosey corner. So I can get to my destiny. I can reach my purpose. Hallelujah. I can do the things that he called on me to do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He removes obstacles. He'll wipe them away. He'll wipe your tears. Hey, hallelujah. Hey. Heart fixer, mind regulator, heaven load bearer. You are my righteousness. My God, that is who you are. Heart fixer, y'all. He's a heart fixer. Heart fixer, mind regulator, heavy load bearer. You are my righteousness, my God.
That is who you are.
Hey, he's a
heart fixer, mind regulator, heavy load bearer. You are my righteousness, my God. That is who.
Heritage Day, right? I don't speak another language fluent enough, but I know the heavenly language. Hey, so no, both say, hey, hope, glory, hallelujah, hallelujah, hey, hey, you're the most see, glory to your name, hey. Listen, y'all. Hallelujah! Hey! That is who you are! That is who you are! That is who you are! You are a way maker!
Yeah. we serve a good God this morning. We serve a great God.
Come on, give him a good praise. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on, we can do better than that. Come on, put those hands together. Come on, look to someone and say, he's good. Come on, the Lord is real good. Come on. Put those hands together. Come on. Come on. You are good all the time.
All the
come on,
time.
Testify in one
you
voice.
You are good.
Different, but we have so many different cultures. And the prophetic word that came to Bishop years ago, even before he was a minister, would be that he would minister and pastor a church that would be of multicultural generations. We were in Jacksonville, Florida, had traveled to Valdosta, Georgia, Moody Air Force Base, and we received that prophetic word. And there we are today. This is why we do Heritage Day. So celebrate, celebrate. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Hallelujah. So look around you. We don't embrace racism here in this church. We declare the word of the Lord that we in our churches will be the biggest gathering of multicultural people in the world. Come on, that's something to shout about. It's something when we can be divided in our workplaces, but it's another when we come together and we can gather with different races. Amen. And our motto, our vision is to minister and welcome to all people regardless of what? Their race, their economic, their religious, hallelujah, status. And we will minister to all people as we minister the kingdom of God. Amen. I'm sorry. I'm excited. But as you are standing, we're going to ask that you would get out of your seat and greet someone that you did not come in the same car with on the count of three. If you're here for the first time, would you kindly raise your hand? We'd like to acknowledge you. We have some first-time visitors here. and they're right in the center here. If you would take the time to go and greet them. God bless. Enjoying yourself already? Amen. Sometimes I just wish we could just go on and on and on. We just pray. We're going to have some praise nights. Praise nights. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. We got some things out. Y'all look good. Y'all look real good. We're celebrating different cultures. Y'all look good. Even with your regular clothes on, you look good with your. So they said, somebody said, that is my ethnic attire. I'm coming as me. But you're so excited.
say. At this time, I'm going to give over to the announcer. Let the announcer go ahead and come before we administer the offering. If you have questions, I think the ushers do have some cards. If you have questions, and we're trying to streamline it, we'll give some disclaimers before we start, so that if you want your question to remain anonymous, that you can do that, because we don't want to say anything or that may be embarrassing to someone. Oh, the questions are for the relationships. If you are in a relationship, marriage relationship, dating relationship, workplace relationship, a parent relationship, friendship, sister to sister, and you want to ask a question, we're going to play some microphones out, and we already have some questions that have been submitted to us, but we want to try and answer that during this time. So we're excited about what God is doing. So the ushers are going throughout. I think they have the cards. If you want to take a card, pass it down. And you know what? If you just want to take one and don't put anything on it right now, just to take one. We don't want no one to say, oh, I know what hers look like. Don't fold it. Don't do anything else different. Because when we take it out, we just want to be able to read it and administer health to us, all our relationships, because we know that God's been doing that already. Let's receive our announcements.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Well, I'm excited because I look behind us. Oh, there's something good in store for us. And so, with that, let me be very quick with the announcements, because, ooh, I'm excited. I'm anxious. I want to get to the good part. I mean, this is good too, right? How to be connected. But the good stuff. Ooh. All right. This week, with birthdays and anniversaries, on today, we have two birthdays. We have Kennedy Banks. Ooh. And we have Nathaniel Wells Jr. And then on the 26th, we have Johnny Humphrey. Amen. Amen. And then on the 2nd, we have Anthony Janeway and Elena Tisdale. Woo! Amen. We thank God for each and every one of them. Make sure you reach out and tell them that you love them and wish them all the best. Amen. All right. A few quick reminders. We're still on the prayer line every day, 5 a.m. Join us. Invite others to join us. Also, coming up this week, for members only, we have the State of the Church address. So that's this Wednesday. This Wednesday, February the 27th at 7 p.m., all members, only members, should come out, okay? And so this is where we get to hear what are we doing, how we have progressed, and all that God is doing in this ministry. Amen? Okay. coming up, this is a new announcement, so make note. If you're interested in being water baptized, there will be a baptism service on March the 10th, but you must sign up and attend a mandatory class on Wednesday, March 6th at 7 p.m. So again, you must sign up, and you must sign up by Wednesday, March the 6th, and you must attend that class on March 6th at 7 p.m., okay? If you have any questions, you can, of course, always call us here at the church, or you can email church admin Tyler. So Minister Tyler over here can answer your questions. You can do so by speaking with her in person and or by sending that email. Again, that's church admin Tyler at fwcsa.org. Okay? All right. Again, just a few more quick reminders. I know the men have already put this on their calendars. I'm just reminding you, if you haven't put it on your calendar or made arrangements, make sure you do that. Amen. Amen. Because the men of valor are going where? To the Spurs game. Amen. Look at them. They already excited. Okay, ladies, let them go have their fun. Let them go have all of that good guy time. We want them to bond anyway. Go ahead. We'll do something later. Right, ladies? Right, ladies? Amen. 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 Men of Valor, enjoy your time. Go take over the Spurs game on March the 16th. If you haven't already signed up, make sure you do so. I'm not sure if space is available or not, but make sure you go right next door to the cafe and address the question, ask the question if there's still space if you haven't signed up. Otherwise, just make sure it's on your calendar. Amen? Amen. Okay. And then for our young ladies, I announced this last week, but again, we have something special for the young ladies. There's a tea time at the Oasis. How cute is that? Tea time for ages 3 through 13. There is a small fee of $5 for the entry, but the date on this is March the 23rd, but you must sign up in the cafe by March the 17th, okay? I think this is so sweet for our young ladies. And so make sure you, if you're interested and you have someone in those age group, in that age group of 3 to 13, you sign up as soon as possible, okay? Amen. Okay, well, here we go. As I conclude the announcements for this week, we are at the Oasis at Faith Worship Center declaring every service, every seat shall be filled in this place and in the new place. Amen? Amen. And this is 2019, the exceptional year of our God. It is the exceptional year of His kingdom. And we are standing on this word. There shall be no fear in this time. Amen? Forevermore, no fear. Amen? And we continue to stand on Isaiah 46, 9 through 10. Hallelujah. And it says, remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. Amen. So good. No fear. Amen. Amen. Well, it's time to give. Woo! Opportunity time.
Morning. Hey, as I look out there, I see different cultures, different dress and stuff. I think of identity, I think of heritage, I think of many things, and I'm sure that you all think of those things also. When you think of Faith Worship Center, there's an identity, there's an inheritance in being at Faith Worship Center, just like that inheritance that you all received there. But that inheritance didn't come free, it came but with work. Work from those who came before you. Work from those who are sitting here right now. Same thing with Faith Worship Center. I think of the inheritance. I think of Rivas Street and where we came from and the journey that we took in order to get here. It took a lot of work in order to get here. Individual work. And it took a lot of offerings. A lot of giving. Giving you not only your personal time, but of your finances. We're about to venture into a new inheritance. The one that we're going to leave for our children. All right? Well, our children. My child already got this. Her children is going to get that. Right? Her children is going to get that, and so will yours. But it takes finances, and it takes giving. Your giving, liberal giving. Hey, God's giving it to you. He's given to you cheerfully. You give it back or give some back cheerfully. Think of the legacy in which you're going to leave for your people. Let me get on to this right here. Oh, man, I've done teared up here. My eyes are done. All right. I'm going to be coming to you from Proverbs 3 and 9, and I'm going to be reading the Amplified Version. And it says, honor the Lord with your capital and sufficiency, from righteous labor, and with the first fruit of all your income. So shall your storage place be filled with plenty, and your vats shall be overflowing with new wine. With new wine, you all, let it linger as you stand with that prepared offering. With the offerings in your right hand, just repeat after me, or with me. Father, your word says in Luke 6 and 38, because I am a cheerful giver, it shall be given back to me in good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing, causing men to give unto you. Therefore, Father, I thank you that you have already prepared somebody, somewhere, to use their abilities, their power, their resources, and their influence to benefit me as I benefit the kingdom of God In Jesus' name, amen. With all heads bowed. Father, we thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for where you've brought us from, oh, Father God, and what you've got planned for us, oh, Father God. We thank you, Lord, that we've got cheerful givers amongst us, oh, Father God, that will enhance, will guide us, will lead us, will help us to get to that inheritance in which we leave for those people to come, the future generations, the future prayers, oh, Father God. I thank you, oh, Father God. The future worshipers, oh, Father God. I thank you, oh, Father God. I thank you, Lord, for all that you continue to do, Lord. For being a loving God, I thank you, oh, Father God. For being a caring God, I thank you, oh, Father God. For being a providing God, I thank you, oh, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for all those who will come forward on this day, oh, Father God, with an offering to give, oh, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for those who have it in their hearts but not in their pockets at this time, oh, Father God. We ask for blessings upon each and every one of your people, oh, Father God. All this and more, I thank you in your son, Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, you're under direction of your ushers.
Thank you for your liberal giving. Just a few ice moments we want to go to. And I believe we're going back to the Tisdale household. All right. Isn't that beautiful? That's one of our own. And it says Elena and Leah and Sister Miriam participated in the Forever in Blue Jeans pageant, the Citrus pageant, and the Pink Palooza. Pageant. Elena won fourth place in the Forever Blue Jeans pageant and Prettiest Smile in the Citrus pageant. Leah, made top, thank you, 10 out of 30 young ladies in the Citrus pageant. Miriam, which is mom, isn't she lovely, won fourth place in Forever in Blue Jeans pageant and made top 5 in Pink Palooza pageant, along with winning You've Got the Look in the Pink Palooza pageant. Way to go, Tisdale family. All right, and next, we have Nevaeh Veals. Nevaeh's in the third grade and has received all A's, honor roll, and perfect attendance for the first quarter. And she's a Kingdom Builders Christian Academy alum, and so we're so proud of her. Way to go. Amen. This represents Christ and makes the Oasis look great. Amen. Keep it up. Let's see. One more. We do have Taylor Hamilton. We know as Taylor Rankin. Hampton. Yes. I'm sorry. Made the Dean's List. There she is over there. We're so proud of you. We're looking forward to her getting that degree and coming back and putting that into work here at the Oasis. All right. All right. Then we go over to the Hayes household. Diamond Hayes Honors Award. C- Come on. In recognition of her academic achievement based on your spring 2018 and fall 2018 cumulative averages, congratulations on your hard work and dedication. Way to go, Diamond. All right, I know there are a few more. I don't have them in front of me. Is that it? All right. I know we were going over to... Oh, that's it? Is something going to play? Oh, that's something with some shout. That's like a praise break shout. That's right up my alley right there. I'm like, oh, we're fitting it. I know we're going over. We're planning to go over to Sister Robin's house. Didn't you? She made something. Come on up. Come real quick. Real quick. We have to let her tell it real quick.
Thank you. Praise God. I just want to say I prayed and told my husband I wanted to make the dean's list, but you know the God we serve, He give you above what you ask. I made the provost list. The provost list is a GPA of 3.7 to 3.99. So I guess I got to make the president's list now. That's the 4.0.
Come on, give God a praise. Now that's some shouting good news. Come on, you can do it. You can do it. You can do it. She can do it. All right. Go ahead now. That's what we say. Go ahead now. All right. Bishop, are you coming? Yes, sir.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Are you excited about today? Well, one of the things you want to do, this has been our relationship month, and we've been dealing with relationships from males to females to marriages to singles and so forth. And so today what we want to do, you going to stay right there, pretty girl? You should look so pretty. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. What we're going to do today is we have a panel of people that's going to be coming. We'll ask you all to just come on up right now. And we're going to do something a little bit different. Church is going to be a little bit different. Oh, we're going to introduce him. You want to do that, too? Well, let's introduce him once they get on stage. See, I'm talking. She already interrupted me already. we're going to ask our participants to come on up at this time. And as you come, I want you to come and have a seat on the stage. Do I see them? Are they coming? Those of you who filled out cards, I want you to pass them out to the ushers if they've already been completed. And you come on up, Brother John, and put a mic on each seat for us. And then we're going to get started. ¿Qué pasa, mi hermano? ¿Cómo estás? Ah, así. Okay, so we're getting situated. Have a seat, Pesky. You good? One of the things that we've discovered, or what we're looking for now. Okay. One of the things we've discovered in relationships is one of the first things the enemy tries to do is to get you from not being in agreement. Okay? Because he knows if you are not in agreement, then the supernatural can't happen. Okay? So what we want to do today is we want to talk about some things. You got some questions that you have in front of you. And Sister Carl, I know Brother Mario called me this morning and said he wasn't going to be able to make it. But won't you just scoot on over right there? That's right. And I'll tell him how good you look this morning. All right. And so I'm going to ask, starting to my left, if you just introduce yourself, and we'll get started.
Brother Jesse Rodriguez.
Stephanie Rodriguez.
I'm Willie Byrne. I'm Carla McGee.
Well, praise God. One of the things that we've discovered in... can I just sit up a little bit? Yeah, thank you very much. All right. One of the things we discovered in relationships is that when you commit yourself first to God, it becomes easier. And notice I said easier. But if you've ever been married before, or if you desire to be married, you find out that relationships are not easy. Can I get amen here today? So, Minister Deborah, are you going to help us out today? Are we going to put microphones in it? They're coming right now, okay? So let me have some of the questions that we may have.
We have some already
here.
Very
good. Let's look at them right now. And let's go from, take it from there.
All right. So our first question that we received is, how do you get your spouse to agree on saving and budgeting We want to buy a house, but we can't agree on how we spend. All right. Before we get started, we are going to open the mic, and we always want your family members to approve of what you say or ask publicly. That's why we're asking you to put it on the card, because they won't know that it's you once you place it, and we will decipher and blot out names or particular things that we think. We're like, what's that show used to be, Dragnet? The names have been changed to protect the innocent. So some of y'all too young for that, but just look on YouTube. Dun-da-dun, dun-da-dun, dun-da-dun. So we want to protect the innocent, and we want to preserve what we're doing is in good integrity, and these are integrity-filled people that we've asked to join us. Many of you could have been up here, but this is what we... So we ask that you trust the wisdom that we're going to share with you, but at the same time, the disclaimer is make sure that you've cleared that before you maybe ask something. If we think it's something too sensitive, what we have on the cards, then we're going to table it, and then we can do that maybe in private if you want to come forward at that time. All right. So
let's read the question again.
The question again is, how do you get your spouse to agree on saving and budgeting? We want to buy a house, but we can't agree on how we spend.
Anybody want to tag that one before we go forward? Go ahead, Bridges.
Well, I had been saving already for a while before my wife and we're already married. One of the things I've learned, and my wife has seen the benefits, is during income tax season, most of us do get a return. So when you get that return, doesn't mean you're going to spend it all. That's hard. I think you all want to spend it and buy some new stuff. But if you try it for 2 years, by the time you know it, you may have about $6,000-$7,000 already saved. So you'll start a principle. Then also, my wife knows that I truly believe that I have a wallet this big of credit cards always sent to me. And told my wife, I don't want to work for the credit cards. So I don't want the MasterCard to master me. Well, I don't want Visa to take my vision. So I take those away and I use American Express. American Express gives me points. All
right.
So when we travel, we get free flights. So you start somewhere. So make that principle. Don't think that you got to spend the money. Just try it and go with God's principles, of course, always first. And God will give you the wisdom.
Oh, and I had to learn that from him, because when I came into the marriage, I was off, you know, living off a credit card. So it's good to have a godly man and equally yoked, and you know yourself. So it's good to be equally yoked in that department.
I think men have to. You have to earn that. You have to earn that trust. So it's not that you have to prove to your wife. You just got to show her the results of saving. So I had to earn that with my wife. It wasn't easy, but she saw the results, and, of course, she was on the wagon.
Can I ask something? Was there ever any resistance from you, Sister Stephanie, initially?
Yes, it was. Okay. A little, just a little bit. But I did learn. God showed me, you know, that I could trust him with our finances, because he knew what he was doing. He showed that before, so I learned.
All right, don't be nudging nobody in the audience. Like, you hear that, honey?
But I also want to, it's important that you come into agreement as a couple, because if you don't come into agreement as a couple, then you can't get to the point of what Brother Jesse's talking about. There has to be a trust level factor where the two of you come together, and you have to have the agreement that you want to obtain the same goal. Because if you don't have the agreement that you want to attain the same goal, it's going to cause a problem. Pastor Kay and I, early in our relationship, she used to keep the checkbook. You remember that? And she used to tell me all the time, she says, I'm not the one. I'm not the one to keep the checkbook. But I saw my mom keeping the checkbook in our household. So I thought that's the way it was supposed to be done. Okay? Well, that didn't work for us. Because Pastor Kay is a spender, and I'm a saver. And that's not a bad... Well, that's the truth, yeah. I heard you in my ear.
I just heard a reverb out in the audience.
So it's important for us. We came together. We said, she came and she said, hey, listen, baby, you need the checkbook, because you're the one that's going to, you know, make this stuff happen. And I took over the checkbook. Now, let me also indicate, we don't live by the golden rule. And the golden rule is he who has a gold rule. That's not the principle. Because if you make more money than your spouse, that doesn't mean that you're the boss or the head of your spouse. I want to make sure we get that out in the open, just because you're keeping the checkbook and all this kind of stuff. There has to be an agreement. There has to be a walk of righteousness and a commitment to say that you're going to do it God's way. Everybody with me on that one? All right. Can we go to our next question? Yes, ma'am. Please. You turn the mic on. Yeah, turn it. Push it up.
Okay.
There you go.
Is it? Okay. Hello? Okay, good. You would think I know how to work the mic. I wanted to just ask Brother Jesse and Sister Stephanie, if the tables were reversed, because I hear this a lot of times, perhaps the spouse, the wife, is saved, and she likes to save, and she has a mind to budget because she's mindful of the things of God, but the husband is not saved, and he's the spender. What practical steps and advice would you give to a couple that's in that situation for them to get on the same page? And it kind of goes back to also what Bishop was saying, too, is, you know, you have to come into agreement. But practically, if one is not mindful of the principles of God and one is, and when it comes to finances, what are the practical steps that perhaps you can take to get on the same page?
Well, I think if that's kind of sounds like the woman is taking care of the checkbook. And usually man, well, not usually man, but if any spouse is not taking care of the checkbook, making the bills, they're not seeing that what's really happening. When you see it before your eyes, the bank statement being a negative and whatnot, and the other person doesn't see it, really, you're not in agreement or out of sight, out of mind. You know, you're expecting the spouse to make it work, but it takes two of us to make it work. So I think that's a big key principle is you got to be real in the kitchen, look at the bill, show them, do we really want to do this? In 2-3 months, by the time you know it, we'll be getting some collection letters and whatnot, and that's reality. I mean, you can't hide from bill collectors or IRS. You know, so in another principle, I don't know what you have on, but is to possibly talk to someone as a couple to get some wisdom on a guideline. But you have to want to. You both have to want to make this work, because you don't want to be working all your life and not really enjoying all that you, like Pastor had told me one time, you're not enjoying the fruits of your labor. So start. You know, somewhere. You got to start. Please, you got to start. Be real. Don't get angry with each other. Just hold each other's hands. Pray and say, we're going to start today. You know, we're going to take away this and take away that. No more Bobby J's or Whataburger, you know.
Hey, Brother Jesse, you used a word. You said the word you used was principle. I want to talk a little bit more about that, because whether the person is saved or not, that person still can work the principle. So you don't necessarily have to be saved. It's the principle. And a principle is a law. And a law works every time, just like gravity. If you throw something up, it automatically say what? Come down. So if you save, it's a principle, right? You're going to have more next month. It's just 1 + 1 is going to equal what? So it doesn't mean that the person has to be saved for that to work. What has the happiness, what Brother Jesse's talking about, where you talk to the person and you explain to the person, hey, this is, we don't want to be down this road, because if IRS is calling or somebody else is calling, we're going to have a problem. So we want to work the principle in the whole matter.
And I was going to say, Brother Jesse piggybacked on something that Bishop allowed me to do. I had to see it. It's not that I thought he was hiding something. I was like, it was money that was there. Or like, I'm used to like my daddy, hey, just. But even years into the relationship, years into the marriage, he said, just work with me, work with me. So that means I had to stop doing some of the things that I enjoy even more now doing, you know, being able to go to the store or whatever, but still working with the plan that he has, because out of that, it's moved us from, y'all know I told you about the 3-leg table, to the house that we live in now. And it wouldn't have been possible had he not let me see it. And then I said, oh wow. Even when he retired, I was like, well, where's the money? He said, this is the money, this is retirement, this is this and this. And it was like a shock to me when I actually saw. He said, "Let me come here. Let me show you something." And when he showed it to me, that was when I was like, "Oh wow, I got to work with this."
That went down to $1,100 a month.
Yes, he did. Yeah. Oh yes. All right. Next question, because we know we need to move.
We have a couple of question cards. It says, "How do you successfully keep division out of a blended family? We already separately have children. We're bringing children into the relationship, dealing with baby mama, baby daddy issues."
That is kind of tricky because we are a blended family, well, and that was hard coming into it. So it takes much prayer, counseling. You need to get counseling with your pastors or with someone.
Oh, you're going
to
put that on me, huh?
There you go. There you go.
But it takes patience. Like, we didn't talk to Jesse's older children before we got married. We just, like, we're getting married. Here you go. You know, and they didn't accept me at first. And I'm like, yeah, they didn't accept me. But it took time, and it's taking time, and I have to get to know them. They had to get to know me. And it just took a lot of time and love and showing your love and keeping your mouth closed and not judging and coming in just love.
I wanted to piggyback on it. I had a situation that someone came to me while we were away, and in Georgia, and their situation was with the blended family. To add to that, that with that blending, the husband allowed the children to talk to them in any kind of way without any correction from those adult children. So how did, maybe would that be addressed, and maybe no one's going through or has gone through that, how was that handled?
If the couple do not present themselves as a unified front, kids are going to want to win. And they're going to play to win. So they're going to play you one against the other. So the couple has to respond as a unified front. And when they realize that they can't put a wedge left or right in between them, then they realize, I'm going to have to go elsewhere. Or you're not going to find any support outside the home for what's going on inside the home. So if you have a unified front, then they're going to realize they're going to have to give up, or they're going to try something new. And there you have to present yourself as a unified front again. It's not going to be easy, but they're going to pick the proper time to cause that wedge by playing one person up against the other. And then they might also present themselves in a situation where you're not necessarily putting one against the other, but if you haven't worked it out as a couple, then that's where you're going to have a problem, because they're going to start a little crack in the crevice, and next thing you know, it's going to open up. And if you don't pay attention to it, you got an earthquake and somebody's going to fall in. So you just have to present a unified front. And part of that comes from talking together in advance, figuring out what your plan of action is. Because all of us were teenagers at one time, and all of us didn't buck the system, but we had friends or relatives who did. So present a unified front privately and come up with a game plan. So when these things start to happen, you can address it. And as they happen, privately go back and discuss how are we going to respond to this, and if this changes or if this happens this way, then how are we going to respond? That way it's easier. The other thing about a unified front is when you have an agreement privately and you know what you're representing, then anytime they come to either one of you separately, then they know that one person speaks for both, because you've already had those private discussions. And if you haven't had a private discussion, if you're evenly yoked, you know your partner well enough that you can always say, I speak for the both of us, and he can always say, I speak for the both of us.
Hey, Ms. Deborah, and if the situation comes up and you don't know the answer, you can always say, well, let me ask your mom, or let me ask your dad, instead of, oh, you let me get back with you, so that there won't be a division between the two.
And that's just not with blended families. With our children personally, what we had to decide, because they know who's going, oh no, that mean mama said. But what we had to come to the agreement was saying, we decided, not your mama decided or your dad decided, because, oh, that's the bad person, or that's the person that, you know, then they're going to see which one they could wiggle around in. But we decided that we do. And go a little further, maybe this question is not in there, even when we have relatives that call and ask us for money, we decided.
It's your side of the family.
We decided, not Laquani decided or Derek decided, we decided. And so when we do that united front, it cuts out all, they're not coming up in there like that, because I was manipulative with my parents, and my mom identified, but my dad let me get away with it. So you have to, parents, you have to really, not just parents, but husband and wife, this is the united front. This is one. These are adult children, adult people, united front.
Awesome. That deserves a hand clap. Give a hand clap right there.
May I add, the people that have the extended families, it would be wise to look at those qualities before you get married to see how respectful those children are when, you know, and if you address it before marriage, maybe that would keep from having, yeah, it would help. Because if you didn't manage your children the way they talked to you before we got married, it's going to get worse when we get married. So maybe you need to observe those things and just don't jump into a relationship and not knowing how the person is handling those children.
Awesome. So this one says, if you look at your relationship goals, it says, how can we help each other to learn new tricks and better speak to each other's love language? Okay, it says, how can we help each other to learn new tricks and better speak to each other's love language? I ask for help, and it seems like I'm asking too much or it's a burden.
Let's just for everybody sake, talk to us, Mr. Deborah, about love language. There's a book written years ago, but not too long ago, about talks about love language. I don't think everybody understands when we talk about love language, what that means. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Awesome. So regarding, hold on, I don't want to give you guys misguided information, but it's said that there's five love languages. When it comes to the love language, my love language is words of affirmation. You tell me, like up until 2 weeks ago, if I can just give an example, Bishop finally told me, I'm proud of you. You're doing a good job at the church. And you know, like that just happened.
Finally.
He don't never. But that word, it took me like 5 years of hard work. So mine is words of affirmation. The other one is acts of service, receiving gifts, quality time, or physical touch. So there's five that may speak to each and every one of us. All right, just to read that question again here, it says, how can we help each other to learn new tricks and better speak to each other's love language? I ask for help. Well, excuse me, they put this in, I feel disrespected when I ask for help and it seems like I'm asking too much or it's a burden on my husband.
I think you have to go the analogy route. Sometimes it's hard to understand if that's not how you relate, and so you don't see it as important. And so maybe one of the best things that you can do is to reference something that other person likes and appreciates and say, do you like it when I do this, or do you like it when I do that? Or I've noticed that this makes you feel warm inside. And say, this also makes me feel warm in the same manner. And then that way they see the importance of it, and that might take away the misperception that you're nagging or that you're pushing on something that's irrelevant. Once they've realized how much value it has for you and related to something that has the same value for them, then they realize, oh, okay, it's not that big of a deal, and I can accommodate you in this way.
And I think also it's important too. Tell the person what you want. If you like to be touched, tell them, hey, I like it when you. Pascal, the other day, we were walking, and I think we were attending a meeting in Houston or getting ready to go or something, and I put my arm around her, and so I thought I was aggravating. She said, no, I like when you do that. I'm like, oh, sucky now, man. I was like, see, a lot of times, I'm the type of person where, you know, you got to tell me what you want. That's the kind of person I am. So if she tells me what she wants, it makes it a lot easier. So because my mind is always racing, I'm always doing something. I'm thinking all the time, and she knows when I start biting on my finger, I'm really down in a deep thought. And so I have to make myself conscious to talk to her. And my wife is the type of person where she wants you to talk to her, okay? So, okay, how can I say it? Because we got children in the room. So I have to talk to her all day. Everybody understand what I'm saying? Because if I want to talk at night, it's not something that, I mean, it don't have to be at night, you're right. Society, what you laughing at? Yeah, no, I'm good. No, okay, yeah. So, everybody understand what I'm saying? So it's if it's something that she needs, that means that I have to give it to her. And if it's something that she wants me to do, she can tell me. Okay. One of the things that can be a distractor that we have to work through is saying things like, "Well, would you never take me out to eat? Well, you never told me you want to eat." Tell them what you want. It helps a whole lot, as opposed to maybe something you might have seen on television that seems like all the romantic stuff. You know, it can be worked out in 30 minutes. It don't work like that. It's something that has to go through.
That's 100% right on. I think the approach of the woman when she comes to the husband, make sure that you don't come provoking the husband, because right away the defensive skills will come up. And he already shut down. You know, he's not even interested about listening. So either spouse, I shouldn't just say woman, but it sounds like this is coming from a woman, the question. But either spouse, make sure you go prepared, prayed up. You don't go angry. And make sure you go into understand that you're going to your spouse who you first were in love with. So go with patience. Go with compassion. Let them see the love of God in you. You got to go that way. Because if you don't go God in, God ain't coming out. You know, so provoke is a big thing for me. You know, us men don't like to get provoked. So when you go in that mode, there's no help there. So.
Good place to give a hand clap. Yes, ma'am.
I have the next question. This question says, my ex-wife and I disagree on when our son should get a cell phone. What should I do? So dealing with an ex-spouse can be very complicated, or it doesn't have to be. And I've been in a situation, fortunately enough, where it wasn't that complicated because we both had Ethan's best interest in mind. And so my approach was just always to keep the child's best interest in mind. And sometimes that was, no, you can't get a cell phone. Sometimes it, yes, I need you to have a cell phone because I need to reach you. So always keeping the child's best interest in mind and removing your own frustrations about what the past has taken place, that just, it, there's no place for that to enter because you won't be able to make any progress forward. And like specifically a cell phone or not, typically that's not even the issue. It's typically not even about what you're arguing about. So maybe take a step back and figure out what is the disagreement really about? Is it about a cell phone? Chances are it's probably not. And if it is, then approach it in just a factual way rather than letting emotions just pour out. So step back and see what is the issue really about, and then if it can be resolved with just an adult conversation where we're just presenting the facts and doing what's best for the child, then you probably can reach an agreement, I hope and pray.
And then I like that because we don't know the age of the child that they may be talking about, if it's a 6-year-old or 12-year-old or something like that. So that are maturity of the of responsibility of the child's factors. So that was fun.
My mother-in-law. Not me. It's by always in our business. Sometimes when my wife and I have already made a decision on something, then the next thing I know, my wife is telling me we're doing something different than what we already talked about.
That's a coincidence she got that question, because I just got them and passed them.
My thing is, 3 sons-in-laws, and I have always respected my daughters, and I have never, God's my witness, jumped into business. And they're still married. I stayed in my place. Now, in any advice that they talk about, I'll put the word on them. Y'all know I'm a word person, don't you? I put the word on. The Bible says that when you marry, you made yourself one. And it says, how can you agree except that you walk together? So stay out of your daughter's and either the other way, the son's business. Let them handle it. And they shouldn't be talking too much to their parents about the situation anyway, because it makes it worse. Because it's one, I'll tell my side, and you don't know the other side. And you get in the middle of it, and then somebody didn't tell all the whole story. The half of a story is a lie. See, if you tell this part and leave something off, you've told a lie, because I don't have a story. So I stay out of my children's, my in-law's business. He get kudos for that. And I think that's why it's worked, because I stay in my place. And I had a mother-in-law, and she stayed in her business. If she got in our business, I didn't know anything about it. She's deceased now.
Very good. What advice can you give to families that have bonus children that call the bonus parent by their first name? The children are under 18 and still in school. It irritates me real bad, and I think that's disrespectful. Plus, I'm not allowed to discipline verbally or physically. Please help. Okay. So I am a seasoned parent. So there was no time out when I was growing up. It was, that's it, let the beatings begin. And so you got a whipping. And I say the term beatings freely because you didn't get beat. I'm not promoting or suggesting abuse. It's just that it was taken care of. Plus, when they were disciplining you, they wanted it to be long term. Raise a child in the manner that you think that they should go, and when they get older, they will not go far from that. And so part of that discipline was making you meditate on why you're being disciplined in the first place. And one of the ways to do that was self-meditation. And so you self-meditated as you went out and got the switch that you were about to get that whipping with. And you prayed to God for your mama who was about to discipline you, or your daddy, heaven forbid, with the military belt, so that you could justify and figure out, what do I need to do right not to get this again? My father often referenced a joke. Actually, he said it was a true story when he was a child. A friend of his, and I guess my father was adventuresome as a child, and they would always do things together, a bunch of boys together. And one of his friends was always with them, thick and thin, regardless of what it was they were doing. But when it came time to be disciplined, this friend would always say, rubbing his hands together, "Dear Lord, if you don't beat me today, I'll be good tomorrow. Please help me out of this spanking." It never worked, because he was one of the first persons who told, and he was in the thick of it the whole time. So in regards to discipline, verbally, yes, because once again, you're not presenting that unified front. And back then, yes, physical is what happened. And it didn't just happen in your household where you lived. It happened outside with your immediate family. It happened with the neighbors, because then there really was a village effort. And everyone took part of that discipline in the raising of that child so that you were well-rounded in the end. So physically, depending on how laws are now, that can be hard unless the child is young. Verbally, definitely, because they need to see what happens when one person says, the other person also says. So you need to address that. Now, as far as first names are concerned, I'm personally living that type of example. My child is 16, just turned 16 in,
in December. So this is a relationship that is new to her. And she was trying to figure out, how do I get right with this relationship and show respect and also address my discomfort at the same time? But that becomes an agreement between the couple that both thinks it's okay and that bonus parent accepting that from that child. And if you have an agreement in that sense, then this is the way that I'm going to respect you until I get more and more comfortable. But I'm not going to say it because it's my choice to say it as the child. I have to have the blessing of that parent and the parents in general in order to say that. But you're not going to call that person out of their name because that's disrespectful.
That's good.
Una hija no puede hablar con los padres en una familia en cualquier manera que quieres. Necesita dar respeto todos los veces.
What do you do when your spouse is unsaved and uninterested in being saved? Well, you're married now. So you got to deal with it. You do a lot of praying. That's why yoked together before. You know, you need to be on one accord before you get married. So if it's already the situation, counseling, prayer, love. Don't go home nagging like a dripping faucet. there are great examples right there. They would talk about Pastor K going to church and talking about the deacon or the man with the foot. Oh, preaching. So they're role models right there. So it can come out for the good. Just keep on loving on him or her and praying for them and laying hands on them when they're asleep and anointing them with oil. And just don't go home nagging and talking ugly towards them. Don't go home nagging.
And they wake up all what was that?
No, just kidding. Also, there's a scripture that says the wife, the way she carries herself, can win him. He'll see the change in your life and what you're doing and the love that you're showing him and others, and you can draw him to the Lord. So always, if you have a situation in your life that you don't have an answer for and you're analyzing, go to the back of your concordance in your Bible and look up that scripture and stand on that scripture.
I was thinking about when Sister Stephanie said that some of the things that I've heard, seasoned mother in the Lord, she's going to be the Lord, my mom in the Lord, she told me, she said, Thomas, what men have a problem with that are unsaved is when they'll hear them do what the pastor or that preacher told me, and you cooking or doing something, or you going up to the church doing something, when your husband has asked you, your unsaved husband has asked you to do something, you won't do it. That's a turnoff, makes him not even want to come. You're going to respect a man that you don't even, and then he'll turn around and say, you must be sleeping with him or something like that. You know, that kind of thing makes that type of atmosphere. So you have to be careful to do what your husband, your priest, your Lord is doing at your house before you come to the house of God and try and please, you know, the pastor or to please something at church. And so that's wisdom, as both of Sister Stephanie and Dr. Brown are saying, is that you have to make sure that you're doing that, appeasing him at home, and then he'll be won by your conversation, not by your braiding your hair and all that good that stuff, but what are you doing to make sure that you're, you know, obeying me, you know? And I know we don't like that word, but it's obey. And so,
all right, so we have a question here. Yes, and I really want to hear this answer because I'm kind of dealing with this right now. It says, how do you balance the boundaries of power distribution between parents and their adult children? It says, my point of view is ignored and I'm controlled. They insist on me being an adult, but then they treat me like a child.
Well, Minister Deborah, let's just start with you.
So since you put it out there.
I'm
reading the question card, right. Pastor Cal. Yes. Read the question.
Are you just asking for a friend?
Yes, now, I'm asking for a friend.
Okay. All right.
What were the responses?
No.
So, again, the question is, how do you balance the boundaries of power between parents and their adult children? My point of view is ignored, and I'm controlled and insist on being... I am an adult, but they treat me like a child.
Do they live in the house with that parent?
It does not say.
Okay, so we're going to assume both ways. If they don't, then their power is self-imposed or self in their mind, maybe. If it is in the home, then they have some boundaries. It might be a curfew. It might be cooking, cleaning. You know, it's kind of open. I'm just going to answer and allow everybody else to maybe chime in, those that want to chime in, but be a conflict of interest. It could be a whole lot of things since we don't have that person. Unless it's you, we can deal directly.
No, ma'am. It's not me.
I do want to add something to that, though, because we're very fortunate to have all of our children living with us at our house. That
Help
was not
us,
the
Lord,
plan. Yes, Lord, Holly.
Yes,
oh, my mind. That definitely was not the plan. But I have to say at this point, I'm grateful because there's a bigger plan. One of the things that my wife and I, we prayed for was for our entire family to be in ministry. Okay, we believe in the principle that this is our family business. This is us. This is what we do. And so I didn't want to be the pastor that had where, how can I say it? But they said the pastor has the worst children in church. Anybody know, ever heard that before? Yeah, well, that ain't true because y'all got some bad children too. So, but I say that to say this. Now that everybody's at home, everybody's there, and they came back in a different role. A discussion we had not too long ago at our house, we had a big family meeting. We had the children around and so forth. And I told my children, I said, well, you're at the point now where you can make your own decision. And I'm like, well, you know, my thoughts is about the grandchildren, really not about you. And my daughters looked at me and said, Dad, but you always have to be dad. I'm like, well, I'm always going to be dad, but my focus is not on you anymore. And they're like, but.
And that's where I have to intercept with them girls. You notice he said them was them girls. I have to intercept when it's them girls. Like, what she texting, what she saying, $500, what?
But see, I wasn't gonna sit down by her boy, right? But it's about the roles change, and so it really has to be about respect. We just had a family meeting here. This past weekend we were in Houston, and every year my family and I we go to this thing called the First Family Conference, and the First Family Conference is about making sure ministry don't steal your family. Okay, so we get to go get ministered to. So while we were there, all of us around the table, if you live in our house, you're around the table, and we're sitting there, we're arguing back and forth, and we're just going at each other, you know, about this, and, you know, Deborah wants to be the boss, and Deandre's like, well, if you got to be the boss, I don't want to work for you, you know, all that kind of stuff, and just going all, I mean, just going on and on. But when we left the table, we got a better understanding. And a lot of times, if you're not willing to sit down and talk about it, then you can't get any results. What happens a lot of times is people just go in their corner, okay? And so it never gets to be resolved. You just run into your corner, they run into their corner. But there's no meeting of the minds where you can come together and say, we got to make this thing better. I would say to that person who's living in that parent's house, number one, always respect them as your parent, okay? That's first and foremost. I tell my family all the time, the one thing that you have more than anything and you will always have is your family, okay? So the family has to be united. Once the family is united, then you start talking about those roles. Okay, you're 16 and you still got to come in at 10 o'clock. Okay, we talk to your parents about why you have to come in at 10 o'clock. Maybe it's because you snuck somebody in the house before.
That wasn't me.
See, I wasn't going to put our family business out like that. Yeah, but you don't know the situation as to why. And so by talking to your parent, you can kind of get down to the bottom. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so I have an adult child. No, I can't even call him a child. He's 6'4". An adult person in my home.
And I totally agree with that. We will sit down. There will be maybe two or three days at a time where we don't see each other just because scheduling and he's working a lot of hours. But at some point during the week, we'll come together and sit down at our kitchen table and just talk. How is your week? And I'm hearing what his needs are and trying to find ways to support him. I think I can speak for you that my support of him, I would say, makes him want to be there and want to do whatever it is that I need. Maybe it's a certain time coming in at a certain time or whatever the needs of the home are. It's very agreeable because there's that reciprocation and he's not a child anymore and I can't just say do this and do that. I'm not, the power is not all mine. It's somewhat shared now because I don't want him going out into the world not knowing how to manage stuff. I want to give that power away in its appropriate time so that he is a successful person once he does leave.
Just to clarify, we had a quick text update. They want to know, how do you create the boundaries? Are you saying by sitting down with your family? Or how do you create the boundaries even though they're in their parents' home?
Well, that started when he was brought home from the hospital. So the boundaries have to have been in place for some time. You can't just not parent and then expect when they're at a certain age that you're going to start parenting. So those were in place all along. So from the transition we're going through now, it's really not even a big deal because it's been in place for those years. I don't know the answer of if you haven't parented well, how you make that happen. I don't know.
Does anybody have any feedback?
I just wanted to add, I could use this example. Our daughter recently moved back home a year ago or so. 2 years, almost two, she says. So recently divorced and y'all pray for Bishop. But whoever they marry, they must stay at this church. They're not going to Rem Pharaoh's church. We can't control that.
But I said that to say, when she came back, she said, Mama and Dad, what's the curfew? I said, what was it when you left like 12 years ago? And she said, I said, well, it ain't changed. She said, Mom. And so we had to work a little wiggle room with that. You know, it was 11 when she left, I think.
It was midnight.
Oh. Now, doesn't that sound like she got an issue? Let me move on. Let's move on. Because we'll have to have some of y'all come up here and replace us. Oh. Well, anyway, that was that point, so we can move on. But we had to address that and accommodate. And, okay, I can spot you another 30 minutes, but after that, the lights go out, the locks. Hey. And I'm setting my alarm to make sure if you ain't in here, this is what we're going down like that.
We have a quick comment from the audience, please.
I agree. I have a daughter, almost two adults in my house. And I come from my house, my rules. Our rules, sorry, baby. I piggyback on Sister Hottie. It starts at home and spreads abroad. You cannot just start parenting a whole adult. But from day one, it was, this is what we going to do. We going to sit down, have a whole conversation. You don't like it? There you go. You know, that's just what it is. But it's rules and regulations everywhere you go. Hotel, friends, family. It just is what it is. You don't like it? Go get your own.
Okay.
Oh, we have another comment.
Oh, to the mic, if they can come.
Oh, yes. Can y'all come to the mic, please? If y'all have a question or a comment, please.
Have a conversation, just a comment about that. True story. I have I've been divorced before, but when you talk about grown children, there's a conversation that needs to be had if they're still at your home. In that, and I agree with you all, when you've parented, however you've parented, but the world is not such a safe place. So if they're under your covering in your home, you have that authority to have that conversation with them that, hey, I have this set in place that I can be assured that you'll be home, because I need that assurance that I'm doing my job as a parent to you for your safety, because I need to know that you're going to be with us tomorrow. I had a brother-in-law, and he's gone on to be with the Lord too, but he was out late doing God knows what, and he was shot to death. But he lived up under their household. He was 19, 20 years old, but he lived up under their household. And just because you think you're grown does not mean that when you get into a grown situation that you can handle that. So if you don't have your own key up under your own roof, then you need to be subjected to and submitted to what they put in place. And I'm not looking to you all, because I understand that you all are parents, and I'm a parent too. And that's one of the things that I fear when my kids get grown. I have an 18-year-old. And
no fear.
Well, yeah, I thank you. Thank you for that. There's no fear of me protecting what I have. But like I said, and how you bring up your children, if you've parented them or not, and we are prayerful people, certainly. But if you don't know what they're into, influences, you can pray. But you may be praying that you're going to be with the Lord as well, because something can out there, wicked things that they're involved in that might take them under. Nothing to stop you from not having the fear of that.
Can I add something to that, though? One of the things, my son, Derek, he Ubers and all this other kind of stuff, right? You don't never know who's getting into his car and things of that nature. We live in the country, and my daughters, they have to drive, say, from to where we live. It takes a while to get there. And so you see deer on the side of the road. You see hogs and everything else and so forth. And the reason I said no fear is because we choose to live by no fear. And what I mean is, whenever they go out, even my children, just the other day, it was a practice when they were small. They would come, and I have to pray for my children every morning, okay? Well, now they're praying for their children. And so it was interesting the other day that the daughters come by, and I'm at the house, I'm laying on the couch, and they say, okay, Dad, we're getting ready to go. And they come and they put their head down, and Dad blesses them before they leave, okay? Because I'm not going to let anything stop me from question my children. I'm concerned about them, but the Word of God lets us know that He gives His angels charge over them to keep them all their ways. And so, even though I know what they're into, it's kind of like, you know, if only my parents knew everything that I did, and I'm still here. Well, it's because of the power of the blood of Jesus that you speak over their lives. That says, okay, my grandma used to tell us, y'all ain't gonna worry me today. And that was her thing. She'd go to bed and like, y'all ain't killing me. That used to be her statement. Because we were some hellions back in the day. I mean, everything from, I don't want to get in that testimony. But what I want to leave is, it's actually you just like a lead into my next week series, when I'm going to start this series on no fear. Okay. And let me tell y'all, people, God, you really want to be here for that. Because a lot of times people don't live their dreams, they live their fears. And so we got to get us to the point of starting to live our dreams again instead of living our fears. Because Job made a statement. He says that the thing that I feared the most is the thing that come upon me. So you got a 16-year-old kid. That boy's going to be safe the rest of his life. He's going to grow up to be a mighty man of God. He's going to do great things because he's got a praying mother and he's got a praying father. You with me on that one? And so that's why I say no fear. Next question. I'm sorry.
Segue to Sister Heidi. Can you just read that really quick? And this will answer this one.
In our home, we have a curfew, but one of our children continues to push the envelope and disregard it. How do I address it without offending?
Can you start over again?
In our home, we have a curfew, but one of our children continues to push the envelope and disregard it. How do I address it without offending or causing disruption in the process? I wouldn't be concerned about not offending. you may offend, and sometimes you need to offend in order to protect that person. So you don't go in wanting to offend, but that shouldn't, you don't need to worry about offending. You will probably cause disruption, and sometimes disruption is needed to bring harmony back in the home. So
offend, right? But this is so offend.
Pastor K, my daddy offended me every day when he said, sit your tail down. And you know what I did? I sat my tail down. See, a lot of times what we're experiencing in our day and time is parents don't want to be parents. They want to be friends. You can't be a... Come on, I love my children, but I'm not their friend. I'm their father. And because God has given me the authority over them, then it's my responsibility as a parent to nurture them, to bring them up. But the Bible says that the rod ain't going to kill them. But it also says if you spare it, you're going to spoil the child. And that's not every child. Some children, you can just, my daughter Deborah, I can just say, Deborah, sit down. She's like, that one over there and that one over there. Oh, Lord Jesus. Now, she didn't look at it, got that look on her face. But, oh, my goodness. But see, part of hers, though, is she got to see mom and dad in their dumb days. Okay? She got to see, like, years of us just doing all kind of crazy stuff. And so, Derek, though, oh, Lord, help us today. I got called to the school one day. He's a good boy, yeah. But I got called to the school one day because I get up to the school. He's fighting his best friend. And I'm like, Derek, what's up with that? He's like, but Dad, he talked about my mama. And so he's old now, so I can say, you know, but back in the day, I was like, you should have. No, I didn't say that. But yeah, because back in the day, nobody talked about your mama. You know what I'm saying? But I still had to discipline him because it was wrong. Okay, it was wrong. And so as parents, you have to, they're not your friend. You're hurting them if you don't discipline them. If you don't, you can't love on them so much that you allow them to go to hell. You have to love them so much that you're willing to tell them the truth. Can I get amen on that? And if you tell them the truth, they may get mad. One of my children one time left home. I'm just going to run away. And they ran over to our neighbor's house. And my neighbor said, well, come on in. I'm going to beat you because your daddy didn't get a chance to beat you. And then they called me on the phone and says, hey, such and such is at my house right now. And I want you to know I'm going to let them spend the night here to cool off. But I told them if they don't get out, if they don't act right, I'm going to beat them as soon as you get through beating them. Well, you know what? That's the way I grew up. Okay? And let me tell y'all, some of y'all don't want anybody to say anything to your children. And you will fight when you know that you go to the school. My child will never do that. Yeah, they will. Yes, they will. And they say sanctify. They're going to shout on Sunday morning. And then come school on Monday, they're going to get around those other children. And they're going to be the same way that you were when you were coming up. So we have to love them enough to say, you know what? I love you, but come on, we got to straighten this out, baby. Come on. Dad don't want you to go to hell. We got to do this. And it's not just a one-time conversation either. Parenting is an ongoing, learning is repetitive. So it's something that has to happen over and over and over.
All right, we're going to change the atmosphere just a little bit. We're going to go over to the dating scene. I'm going to make this a two-part. Are dating apps okay? And in a dating relationship, when should the man pay for the meal? When should the woman pay for the meal? And when should the cost be split? So two parts. Answer one or the other. We're trying to keep our time. So again, are dating apps okay? And then in a dating relationship, when should the man pay for the meal? When should the woman pay for the meal? And when should the cost be split? Let's go.
They Google the person's personality on the dating app. Google it. It's out there.
I'll go. So I have used one of those apps a long time ago, and it just, everyone I met was not like-minded, not even close. And I don't know that there's anything biblically wrong with it, but I think you would ask yourself, what are you looking for, and where am I going to find those qualities? And what I'm looking for is not what I was finding there. So that, for me personally, it's not okay because it's not giving me what I'm looking for.
Check
the credit score.
The meal should the man pay? When should the man pay? When should the woman pay? And when should it be? She said she won't answer that. All right.
When Pastor K met me, I was working on a pecan truck. Okay, I used to go pick pecans, and I think I was making like $3 a bucket or something like that. I couldn't afford to pay for the food. So when we went out on a date, we made a deal. You pay for the movie, I pay for the...
You tricked me.
Yeah, I did trick you. But it worked, didn't it? Yeah. So it's in every individual is totally different relationship. I'm a chivalry type person, and so I believe that I should have to pay for it. As a man, I like doing that. But ladies, I would also say beware of men, as Pastor Kay said earlier, who has those alligator arms. You know what I'm saying? Who don't want to pay for nothing. You want to watch them and just be aware. But I also say this. Ladies, please understand from a male's perspective, a lot of times, if they're paying, they're going to want something else. So you want to make sure that you know the person before we start getting all the way down that other stuff, because a man's mentality, he's a hunter, and hunters hunt. Everybody with me? And so if they go out and they spend a lot of money and do all this other kind of stuff, if they're not a holy and a righteous person, they're going to have some other expectations, and we don't believe that. Well, okay, but she could be the same way, so we want to watch that.
And those expectations refer to the dating site. I was encouraged many times to go to the dating site. I never did because I grew up old-fashioned. There were no dating sites. However, I have vicarious experiences of people who visited dating sites. If you're going to the dating site because you're looking for Mr. Right Now or Mr. Cute, then you're going to wind up with a bunch of spoiled apples, because they're not looking for anything permanent either. You're just looking for someone to entertain you and someone to go out. And if you're trying to be social, then that's what you'll get. And as long as you know that in advance, there's nothing wrong with that, because you can set up your own boundaries. However, I also know people who chose dating sites because they didn't find anybody in church. They didn't find anybody in the social circles that they were going into. So they were very particular about answering those questions in a detailed manner, because they knew in advance they were looking to be married. And they knew in advance they were looking for someone that was equally yoked. Two examples in particular, they filled it out in detail and very quickly. By answering questions on the phone, they knew this was a no. By going out on a date in the first 10 minutes, they knew this one was a no. And if you lasted through the first date and went to the second date, it generally led to them being married, and they're still married to this day, but they knew in advance. And in each of those cases, they gave themselves a time limit. Just out of curiosity, they had faith that God was going to take care of them. And in each of those cases, it was the last person that they met, and they had almost gave up, but they said, you know what? You know, I kind of made a vow. I made a commitment. I had faith that this was going to work out. And when they met that last person, they were equally yoked. They had the same idea about finances. They had the same idea about relationships. They had the same idea about family. And they got married, and they are now, each of them have been married anywhere from 15 to 20 years. And it worked. But that's because they knew in advance what to expect. And so as far as the check at the same thing, you know in advance what to expect. But don't go and chase somebody because they have a black card or because they have a deep wallet. And if you're really committed to that person, then you start living that the two shall become one, if necessary, as you grow. And then that way you respect each other. Because if you want something that's outside of that other person's realm and you really want to experience that together, then that might mean it may come on you on occasion. But if you want the relationship to grow, then your focus is on the relationship, not the dollar.
All right. We're going to take these next two questions in a second. But to the single ladies, the Bible talks about with Adam, he was in the garden. And so you should always be looking for a man that's already in the presence of God. If you try to get him and then drag him into the presence of God, then that's not going to work, because now it's going to be difficult. Let me just say it's not going to work, but it's going to be difficult. So find him already in the presence of God, already in relationship with God, but not someone that you're going to find on your own and then try to drag him in the presence of God, and he doesn't want that. And so you got to be really careful about that. I hope that helps somebody. make sure you got those priorities first to make sure that he's in the presence of God, not the black card, not the other things that she just mentioned. All right, Sister Robin.
First, I'll say what God has for you is for you. I'm not saying go to the gutter and look, but wherever it is that you're looking or whatever, if it's there and it's for you, you're going to get it. So dating app. Child, I met Jerry Randall, blackpeoplemeet.com. But check it out. Sister Carla hit all of the things because I already knew what I wanted. He already knew what he wanted. I had been married previously, and I was like, okay, all right, I'm going to see. And I wasn't like, let me see, can I find me a man? I just put it out there, and that's the arena, because I said, God, I can find a man. I'm good at it. Not. I screw it up. So I'm going to allow you to do this thing for me this time. And when I did, and we talked, our initial conversation, you know, the what's your name, whatever. And he said, I asked him, what was his last name? He told me. I said, well, okay. He asked me how long I had been in my city. Well, guess what? That was his hometown. I ain't never been to Lufkin before in my life. But anyway, God had me there. So, and he asked me what my, I said, there's a person in my church with the same last name. He said, what church do you go to? And I told him what church. He's like, what church? And I repeated it. Child, that was his home church. Check. We are already equally yoked, because I know he's getting the same teaching that I'm receiving. The next thing is who should pay? You know, he should pay, she pay, we pay. This is what happened with us. We started having conversations about marriage and life. We ain't talk about, you know, let's go do this and let's go do that because, you know, we just want to be social. Don't get me wrong. You have to check those blocks, but we've already been there. We've already done those things. We know what we want. So one day, he looked at me and he said, woman, you gonna marry me? And I said, yeah. And that was the proposal. And here we are.
That's what I'm
Give him a hand. Yeah.
So everybody should go to blackpeoplemeet.com, right? Everybody. Right.
I have three young daughters. I have a daughter that's 25, one that's 23 that's married here, and one that's 20. And my first daughter, the oldest, it didn't work out so well. My grandchild was here probably 2 weeks ago. I think this, when it comes to dating, if you're Christian, is he who finds a wife. Come on, sir. You got to be found instead of look. If you're wife material, he's going to find you. What happened to my oldest daughter, she went out and found him. And we got a whole situation with that. But my middle daughter, the guy found her. And then when she found the guy, they brought the guy to me. Man, here it is. They brought him to me. And the guy lined up. He has a similar background like my background. Young guy, special forces guy, going to be a PA in San Antonio, just got here. When you go out and be found instead of finding, God gives you what you want and need. So he who finds a wife finds a good thing. Don't go out and find a husband. A husband is supposed to find you, because when he finds you, he's going to take everything that you have, whether it's good, bad, or indifferent. You got to go find her. And then when you, ladies, when you're found, you got to be a wife instead of a knife.
Well, wait, don't go so fast. Oh, because we got some that might say, wait. How they gonna find me if I ain't out there? If I don't put me out there to know that I'm found? They got technology today.
Pastor, you know I know some Bible. Listen to me. If you, same thing with church. You know how I'm winning my wife to come to church? Because she comes from a different culture. I get dressed up every single time. I look good every single time. I'm pleasant every single time. And every now and again, when she goes to work, you know what she says? Who's sitting by you in church? I said, nobody. Who's sitting there? She'll text me. Who's sitting there? What did they talk about? And eventually, if I keep doing what I'm doing, smelling good, dressed up, car clean, coming, sitting in the same seat consistently, guess what's going to happen? She's going to stop, want to work on Sunday and come up here and sit next beside, even if she's just being nosy.
That's her right.
That's how I got here. I was nosy.
Brother, you still got some singles that saying, I need to be out there.
Well, see, back in the day, though, the husband used to pick, the father used to pick the person for their...
The arranged marriage.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, I got that look over in that corner over there.
Yes.
Were you waving your hand?
Yes, Bishop, I'm with you. I wouldn't have married my wife if not that my parents were behind it. There's no way it could have been possible. There are suspicions, you know, when we're coming from that side and want to marry women from Western world because of the cultural differences. But the way my wife came to me through a recommendation by a brother.
She said your brother recommended your sister, your wife to you.
Yes. In Germany. I was with that in Africa. When the letter got to me, it was just like this, a family gathering. I read it the same time with my parents, my senior sisters, and their husbands. So I had no explanation to make. That's how I knew that the gods were behind it. So I read it. I passed it around, they read it, and they knew I did not make any arrangement for it. They said, well, if your brother did this recommendation all the way from Germany to Africa, I think the gods are behind it. And the rest was a story.
Yeah, your turn. Do you want to come?
We had discussed about the story about dating apps and everything like that. As my husband said, it came from a letter, and I was in the church. And believe you me, come my culture, I'm American, so I knew that I could trust God. And my app was P-R-A-Y, pray. I was 36 years old, church, while still living the life of a single woman. I was too old really to hang out with the single group because, you know, I just weren't there. So I babysitted my married couples and anything that they needed for their children. I babysit them while still P-R-A-Y, praying and letting God know my heart's desire. I was there praying. And you say specific with your prayers. Yes, I was specific. I said I wanted him tall, dark, and a little bit handsome. Amen. So I know God has a sense of humor, and he's specific. But in essence of that, I was single. And yes, I knew about my time clock. It was being reminded. My mom even had volunteered a 65-year-old deacon that she felt, oh, he's a good man. Jesus, Father, I understood. But I thank God that the word of God is quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the dividing asunder, the soul and the spirit, the joints and the marrow. It is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Apps are technology I go for, but praying. See, at the same time the letter was being written and people were telling me, oh, it's okay, just wait on. And I'm looking, I said, now, Lord, I know Sarah was 99. I said, but I do. I can wait until that. But I would prefer I could move around with my children a little bit before they get here. So I thank God that prayer still works. And yes, I was that American woman that, as the Bible talks about in Genesis, as Bishop says, that he put Adam to sleep and he brought Eve to Adam. So I was brought over to Africa and was brought to my husband. Now that's another testimony at another time, but I thank God that prayer still works, because the desires, God, you delight yourself in the Lord, you prepare yourself, God is already working. Now maybe it did take that 36 years to get me to the point where I needed to be, to be presented as a wife. All right, now. But I thank God that he allowed me to see that his word works. So I tell.
So when you went, did you know that you were going to be married when you got there?
No, sir.
So
I didn't know, Bishop. Okay. All I knew was that I was going with them to be their guest. Mm. I had just come from Desert Storm, and I had plenty of leave, and they had asked me to be their guest. And I had been befriended them in the church, his brother, which was what we call first cousins. Mm. And we had all befriended. I knew the food they cooked. I loved that. And I had spent time with them. I knew their children. So they were going back home to present their children. And I was just their guest.
And so when you saw him, did you know it was love?
You mean like first sight?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Give him a hand. Awesome. Come on, we can do better than that. All right. Wait a minute.
So Brother Agu says, come here, let me show you how we do things in Africa. From the motherland. Yeah.
Yes, my bishop. I don't know how much time we have. Yeah, how I knew, my brother had given me all the information about her. You know, she's saved, spirit filled, water baptized, Holy Spirit baptized. But he told me, but not like Nigerian style. You know, in Nigeria, where you're like that, we expect you to dress and cover everywhere like the Reverend Sisters. But I agree with that. And it had just come at the end of my fasting, dry fasting for 3 days. So I knew that something is behind it. Mm. I was 36 too then. I'm only older by a few months. So when I came in, I saw her and I left. Then the next day, my brother made the presentation to her. And I didn't have the problem of selling her to my family because she has already been sold. And like you're saying, I tell my children, I will have a say whoever you're marrying. The choice is yours, but the decision will have a hand in it. That is who you are. You know, so I took her for a moonwalk that night.
Did you go in the bush? I'm sorry, your children in the room.
Yes, it was in the bush. And she surprised me. There was no electricity. You can see the moon and the stars. And what do you call it? Pitch darkness. And she was not scared to walk with me. For over a mile, I said, are you not scared? She said, no. Is unbelievable to me. So when we came back, like you said, I just told her, well, the ball is in your court. I'm ready to marry you. It's like, are you serious? No man has ever told me that. I said, I'm just telling you now. You know, I said, whenever you are ready, I'm ready. So the next day, what she did was like, is that where I can reach my mama? She wanted to call her mother over here. I said, well, you can do that. She called the mama. The mama gave blessing. She called the father. The father gave a blessing. That was January 1996. So she got to go back to Germany. She wanted me to go with her. I'm like, we don't do things that way. I don't need no paper. I'm not ready for paper or any material gain. this is a marriage recommended by a blood brother. So I'm going to marry you before my parents. Go back to Germany. Come back. We marry in Africa. And she did that. She came back in October. And we got married. And ever since then, this is 22 years now.
Pretty good.
Very good.
All right.
I'm a little nervous here, so don't mind that. I got two questions. So the first question is, some coworkers, myself, we were discussing some things, and we had a discussion about happy wife, happy life. I tend to disagree with that, and I just kind of want to know what the panel advice is on that. And I'm going to tell you why I disagree. I hear a lot of, just because the happiest wife, just because the wife is happy, doesn't necessarily mean the man is happy. So if I make the wife happy, what about my happiness? Because the only thing I'm doing is just kind of catering to the spouse. I'm just keeping it real.
Oh, nah, y'all want to say something.
Because at the end of the day, she's happy, but yet I have some issues that I have to deal with in myself because now we're not talking these issues together. I'm just doing things just to make her happy.
What's the part two?
My other question is, I'm recently divorced myself. Dating, because we talked about dating, the dating apps and things like that. Dating. I'm recently divorced. We're talking about dating apps. I don't do dating apps. Obviously, they're out there. But in my perspective or my mindset, the age gap and difference, I'm 50 years old. So at what point, because in my mind, most people my age group, most of them are married. So it's a little difficult now at this age to kind of find that single person. So what's the age gap, if you would? If that's a good question. I don't want to be caught like R. Kelly, so you know what I'm saying? That's a joke.
That's the other church. That's not this church. So the first question...
it's about happy wife, happy life. I don't subscribe to that as a wife myself because that's control. I do believe from my man of God and my husband that he wants to make me happy, but I still have to give my my support for him too to find out what his needs are. And so I believe that every husband should study his own wife. And every wife should study her own husband. Because what I believe about that is God ain't told you nothing about Elder Goodfoot and Sister Goodfoot still sitting there. So, you know what I'm saying? In that aspect. So, I can ask somebody else what they think of what happiness is for their wife. And they may not make that measure. But that cliche or that saying, I don't agree with it because I think it's a control thing.
I think it's about, you know, communication. You letting the spouse know, you know, your needs as well. Like my wife knows I love to go hunting, and she loves, you know, I go to basketball and stuff. So she's not in the parking lot on top of the tree with binoculars watching me hunt. You know, she lets me go. You know, so I get my balance. One of the big things I just heard is you got to study your wife, and the wife needs to study the husband. So there'll be less division when you come to the table just to talk. Some things do slip where I'm not a perfect man, and you know sometimes I got my mind somewhere else, and I'm not paying attention to certain things. There has to be communication. You got to go. There's no way around it. You just have to go because it builds up the anger, the frustration, and anything else will just flare up. You know, so you got to get it at the bud. Got to go as soon as possible and make it right with the spouse, wanting to make it right, not trying to come with an answer already. I know what she's going to tell me, and I'm going to tell her this. Don't practice that because you don't win and she don't win. So just go with knowing that she is your wife. You love her and expect good things with that love connection you have with your wife, and you will be rewarded at night.
Can I
Can I get an amen?
Or during the day.
Yeah. We're about to close up here. We're about to close up. Right?
All morning.
But can I say something? The Bible does talk about, if we could go there for that aspect of happy wife, happy life, when that gets to that point, that means that that brother or that husband is really aggravated and he's doing everything to please her in the aspect just to keep her quiet, but he's not happy on the inside. But the Bible talks about, because Sister Stephanie talked about that nagging, one thing about women, most women, I'm going to say this, the memory is like elephants. You do something, they're going to remember it or they're going to recall. It doesn't have to be anything negative. It doesn't have to be anything negative. We're going to remember it. We remember that, you know, we've been married. We remember the time, the birth of the children, the detail, what the weather, what was going on outside.
What socks you had on.
Or detail. You know, things that a man may think is irrelevant, a woman remembers that. And so, but to segue to that, the Bible talks about a brawling woman. It's better to
be on the house,
just get your bed and live on the rooftop than to be with a brawling, nagging woman, because she's going to never let it die down. And then that looks like that man is probably trying to satisfy that. Whether he's done something or not, she remembers it. He slept around on her, he's hit her, he's done whatever. It could be her nature, how she was brought into the marriage, but it could be something that he's done to make her nag or make her insecure, make her, and then now he's having to make up for that. Even though he don't apologize for it, she still remembers it. And I know forgiveness is always in order, but that could be a factor of that happy life, happy wife. I don't know where that came from, but I just never endorsed it. So we just need to usher it out of this church, and then we're going to help change the world. And get it out. Then we're going to be happy together. A happy life together.
And the age factor, there's no age factor. There's a legal factor. It won't be legal. Yeah. But the age factor, God gives you what you need. And if that person is older or that person is younger, he gives it to us. Okay. If you go after her, then we get what we desire. And I know a lot of times as men, we look first, okay, instead of allowing God to speak to our heart first. So we want to move our heart out of the way and make sure we hear God's voice. And then God will say, that's the one.
Well, Bishop, wait a minute now.
No, I tell you, I look at you good. I know you do.
Hallelujah. But let me say this. Men will say that as long as it's their son. And then, ooh, man, you got it. And then you try to have somebody dating your, a 50-year-old dating your 18-year-old daughter, you'll get a shotgun.
Yeah, but if God says so, then God's
you ain't thinking about, that dad ain't thinking about no God.
If God says
come
so.
Come on now. That man ain't thinking about God at that time. Babe.
If God gives you a 18-year-old that's legal and God gave it to you, then God...
He ain't asking the question. You asking for a friend, right?
Correct.
All
a
right.
Okay.
So,
tell your friend.
Oh, I feel myself getting hot right there. Because men will...
No, I think that's an issue that ladies have when they feel that, you know, this guy might have did this and now he wants a younger version or whatever. I don't subscribe to that. I believe that when God gives you the person, that person is the person that God gives to you. When I went looking for you, I wasn't looking at your age.
You weren't 50 and I wasn't 18. But had that been,
wisdom and you had the body of an 18-year-old.
And I have a
body. You still
of
got
18.
A girl. You still got it going on. You know what I'm talking about.
All right, it's time to go home.
Now, yeah.
But let me say this. Now, come on now. Okay, we're not going to...
But what's wrong with a man marrying a younger woman?
If a 50-year-old man with an 18-year-old woman, we're going to call him a pervert.
Why? Why?
Sometimes...
All y'all ladies, sit down. Sit down. Just sit
down. Sometimes. I'm not saying that. But if you look at that now...
Can I date a 70-year-old man? Is it okay if I date a 70-year-old man?
Is it okay if he does it?
No, because you said...
Old people do have words. But I'm just saying.
Now what y'all doing? Let read my lip. May the Lord watch.
Okay, we got a few more minutes. Were you standing next, sister?
We're gonna close with this, our last one, before we close up from here.
I want y'all to pull a hold up on this. I'm gonna speak for the seniors. Now look, we've got some nice looking seniors that are 60. Some 70s that would put a 30-year-old in the back seat. I'm just saying. So if your 18-year-old daughter want to hook up with a 70-year-old that looks like...
Watch out, Dickie said, watch out, watch out.
Hook up, I mean marry. Okay. But first, he got to be a man of God.
That's true.
Got to be a man of God. Now, where's the brother with the happy wife, happy life?
He left. Oh, there he, oh. He asking for his friend.
Oh, his friend. Will you tell your friend there is no such animal? Because a wife is one with her husband. If she's happy, he's happy. She makes him happy. He makes her happy. And it doesn't matter. Doesn't take diamond rings. I've been married 48 years. And you know the best gift the deacon gave me? I remember we hadn't been married very long. At the time, I had to call Red Cross because his mother was very ill. And we had to go to his hometown. Now, it's small. Real small. Red dirt everywhere. I had a young baby, and the closest base was 55 miles from his home. But I went because he was my husband, and that was his mother. We stayed with her. One day, Rankin came home with this cute little gift. It had nice paper on it, and it had a cute little bow on it, and he presented it to me. When I opened it, I gently opened it. When I opened it, inside that gift was 5 peppermint sticks.
Work it, Deacon, work it, man.
5 peppermint sticks. And I was just as happy if he had given me a multi-million-dollar dime. So, ladies, gentlemen, it don't take all of that. It don't take all of that. You love her. She loves you. Just the simple things. And after being married now, I appreciate just every day waking up looking at his face. Just that simple.
That's good. That's good.
That's it. Now, they were talking about that dating app. How many of you heard about that couple that was arrested in San Antonio? All this new apparatus for dating is fine for some, but you got some abusers out there. So the best way is face to face in somebody's church. And ladies, the Bible say, hide yourself. Hide yourself. Hide yourself. Hide yourself. You get my drift, ladies? You know what I'm talking about? Hide yourself. And when you do that, he gonna see and look and wonder. You ain't got to do all of them. You ain't got to do that. Surprise him. That's why you couple. And looking nice. So he come running. Looking in a church window for you when you go into church.
Amen. Give him a hand. All right.
Hey, brother, before y'all leave, y'all may want to stop by and get y'all a cup of peppermint there. You know what I'm saying? Get there.
Come on, we're getting ready to go. Minister, she's through. And Sister Virginia? Okay. If you'll submit whatever you want, if you don't want to come, but give me an opportunity to come really quick. All right? Okay, no? Submit it, because what we're going to do, we know the time is well spent. We're going to post the responses to these online. We're going to share some of these answers with what we questions, and we'll allow each person to piggyback on it. We'll send it to everyone and get these questions out to you, because we have some very good questions, getting the husband to do things like taking out the trash. Not just taking out the trash, but by on a trash day. So, you know, don't let it just sit there. So we got a whole lot of things that are in here. And bringing the container back in and stuff like that.
There's one thing I want to do before we go. I need two married men to come to this mic. I need two married men to come here. Okay, there you go. I need
you told them with the two men you wanted them to give you $100 each.
Oh.
Because they already...
Oh, no, come on back. Come on. Okay, that's it. All right. I need one child to go to this mic with them. And then I need two...
Any child, not their particular child. Any child. A child. You could be an adult child
that,
or...
That does not mind. Thank you.
Okay, Very good.
Okay. I need a single lady and a married lady to come to this mic. Okay. Now, I'm going to demonstrate something for you. And I need you to do the same thing. Okay? Affirmations are so important. Okay? Everybody say affirmations are so important.
Affirmations are so important.
Okay, so you got to leave here and you got to take something home with you. Because this whole month has been about relationships, right? So I'm going to demonstrate, okay, something for you. Girl, you just look so good to me. And I just thank you for being my wife. Thank you for giving me the children that you've given unto me. God couldn't have given us something better. You are the most beautiful woman in the world. I'm your baby daddy. And I just thank you for loving on me and for being the queen of my life. All right? Okay, now, first brother, talk to your wife. If your children are here, talk to them. In the microphone. Don't rap it, Tony. Hey, baby. Can I get some soft music, Chris?
Well, I could talk about so many things that I miss. You know, when I give you compliments because it's so many things that I'm thankful for that you do for me. My kids, my food. Not talking about my pounds, still telling me I have abs. You know, all of the nice things that you do. There is no woman on earth that I could ever see myself with. From the first day we met, I tried to stay away from you for a year because God was telling me that's the one. I didn't want to give up my single life, but you put me in a place where I needed you. And I still need you. I love you.
Listen. Talk to your husband, talk to your children.
He's going to have a good night.
You want me to talk to him?
Affirm him in front of everyone.
You want me to talk to him and the girls?
You talk to him.
Okay. I tell him I love you. You know that. You my that's babe right there. You I appreciate you. I really do. I tell him this all the time, but he is truly the king, the priest, the man of God, the leader, the provider, the protector, the everything up in our house. I so honor you. So I respect you, adore you. Love is not even like you like really like me. Thank you for liking me. But most of all, from day one, I have laughed nonstop with you. And you make it a priority every day to not put a smile, but I'm talking about stupid laughing every day. And I appreciate you. I like we have our own little language and how we deal with each other, and it's not about money. We have couch dates, bed dates, popcorn dates. We do the simplest things. You know how to, your presence is it calms me. It brings a peace. I'm not chaotic. You taught me and you've taught me so much, and I thought I really knew it. But you settled this firecracker all the way down. And you make me really, truly want to be not just a mother, not just a woman of God, but a wife. Like, you really, you never complain. You never complain. And I love you for that. Even my cooking, I will feed you because you will eat. And I honor you for being truly living in front of the girls and I, the true man of God that walks. I thank you for being authentic and unique. I thank you for being unorthodox because you're just genuine. I love you just for you, and I love you so much for loving me, not trying to change me, but teach me, grow me, to make us build our brand and to be better. And to my girls, I thank y'all for lining up. It was hard. It was hard. It's a lot of history, but God is truly good because my household is peaceful, and I'm not trying to get emotional, but it's real. It's really real to be obedient to God and listen to his voice and wait and not be impatient. And what Mother said, write the vision and make it plain and be specific. Who was that said be specific? That thing is real. That thing, because I'm specific, like, only things God knew I knew. Like, I already, like, what? Like, just the littlest things. Like, I've always wanted a nickname. God knew that. So when he first gave me a nickname, I have one. We're not going to share it. And it's not. I'm Pooh, but nobody knows that because that's a, and I busted out crying. And the things that I was insecure with, he embraced and loved. And I'm a free spirit, and I'm a better mother. I'm working on that. I'm trying to be a better person. I thank you for being obedient. Plain and simple as that. You heard God, I heard God, and here we are, and I'm just grateful. I love you.
Hi, I'm Tori. I'm not a, like, very talkative person, but, like, so my mom's not here, my brother's not here, my dad's not here, so, like, I want to thank my family for, like, pushing me to the, like, my potential to be myself, because my story. I just want to thank them for pushing me, because not knowing, like, that they love me from little past things with my close family, like, just pushing me to do what I want to do in life. And, like, now that I see it, my mom being the great example of a mother for me, seeing that, me going to her school now, changing schools, making me understand why am I here, to serve God and stuff. So I just thank my mom and dad for being here, well, being in my life. And I just thank my brother for pushing me to, like, a different level of my life. So.
You can talk to your mom, you can talk to your grandparent, you can talk to your sister.
To my family as a whole, thank you for teaching me that I am loved and what it means to be loved, and that most importantly, I'm worthy to be loved. Thank you for setting the example for me of what love is and how to love. And that can be in many different ways, whether it's a gift, whether it's making a meal for everybody, whether it's just sitting down and laughing at each other. Thank you for showing me what that means, and thank you for continuing to push me towards love, towards who I'm supposed to be as a person, towards who I am in Christ. I just really appreciate the fact that of how close we are. I appreciate how easy it is to talk to y'all. And I know that a lot of people don't have that, and I feel like growing up in the house that we grew up in, with all of us living together, it was crazy at times, but it was so worth it. And I believe that God had us together for so long for a reason. And I just really appreciate y'all for setting the example for me and for Chrissy, I love you, man. You know, I'm really starting to like you now that we're getting older. You know, the older we get, I feel the closer we become. And you're really my friend, and you're pretty cool, man. You're cool. I love you too, man. All right.
That's it. So awesome. You know, they get me with that, with the man, and Deborah and DeAndre calling each other bruh. I said, what? So that's their love language. Let's give the millennials their love language. We love you too, brah. Yeah.
It's first thing that you
do. The mic on? Say hi. This is. But no, man, with me and my wife and the kids and everybody in the house. Man, y'all run me crazy, man. I ain't gonna lie. Everything goes out the pockets. I ain't gonna lie about that one. But no, to be honest with you, though, it's a blessing, though. I tell my wife every day, she said, what can I do for you? What can I do for you? I said, just keep praying for me. That's all you can do. That's all I want you to do is keep praying. Don't, because I know me. My life is right behind me, the old life. And I said, I'm not going there. Just keep praying for me, and we're going to ride this out. And that's it. Thank you.
I know you asked for certain people to come up, but I made a request. I've lived the blended family life. I lived a blended family life. I did that for about 12 years. So I understand a lot of things you guys are going through, because the blended family life I lived, I came into a marriage of three kids was already in the home. And plus I had my own child. And then along with that, I also did something special, and I adopted my daughter, Kawante. She's a little shy back there. Try not to get emotional, but I just want you guys to really pray for my daughter, Kawante.
Talk to her.
Come on, brother, take your time.
Give me a second. I want you to know. Trying to hold it back. I just want you to know how much I love you. Although that your mom and I are not together, I want you to know that your mom loves you as well too. I know that you're going through a lot of things and you're trying to figure out yourself. I know a lot of the things been a little difficult on you, and we have not talked a lot about what you may be going through.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, guys. But I just felt like at this moment, I need you to understand and truly understand the love, the care, all the things that I have for you. I don't look at you as an adopted daughter. I look at you as my biological daughter, and I really truly want you to understand and know this. I know I may not say how much I care about you, I may not say how proud I am of you, but I want you to understand everything that you do, every breath that you take, every walk that you, every step that you take, I am so proud of you. I want you to truly, truly understand that. I want you to know the things that you're going through, yeah, I may be mad at you sometimes, but I'm mad at you because I truly care about you, and I see so much potential and the worth of that you have in yourself, and I try to instill that into you. So please understand, just because I yell at you, just because I, as you would say, punish you, I do those things because I care. I do those things because I want you to be better than who you're becoming. You have the potential to be so much better at what you're doing. I just want you to truly understand, I care about you and I love you, okay?
That's beautiful. How many enjoyed today? It's been impactful for you. Come on, give God a hand. There are plenty of, as I said, other questions. If you have some, go ahead and deposit it as you exit. We're going to make a receptacle in the back.
Okay. So let's get ready to pray. I wanted some people to come up and say, come on, you come across, bro. Come across. Say something to their loved ones. No, you can go ahead. Is because life is so precious and life is so important, and a lot of times we get so busy that we don't talk to the people that we really love. On yesterday, Pastor Ken and I, we came back in town. And we went by Mother Graham's house to see and to pray with them, because her daughter had passed away on yesterday. So right there in the house, that conversation ended where she can talk back to her and her back to her. I was talking to Brother David in the back, and he was just saying, Pastor, man, thank you so much, and I want to tell church thank you for what they did for my sister at her funeral. Now, you don't know how much time you got with the people that you have with you. We can't waste time anymore. Love somebody, you got to tell them. Come on, you got to tell them. You got to love on them. I guess I'm getting older, Brother Jesse. I guess I am, because the other alternative is not to. I tell my family all the time I love them. I tell my son all the time I love him. I try to tell the church all the time I love you all. Those are not just words. That's coming from my heart. Because I want to see you become everything that God has for you. I want you to become that person. You can't hang around me and not become that person. Okay?
And so that means we got extended arms. Some of you got to go back and you got to call somebody today and you got to apologize to them. Some of you today got to talk to your spouse and begin to just tell them how much you love them. Some of you have to go back and start talking to your children and tell them, hey, you know what? Dad loves you, man. Mama loves you. It's called genuine love. And so many times we get caught up in this rat race called life, going in all different directions, trying to get this and following after all this kind of stuff, that we don't become everything that we have, because who you're supposed to become is that person that God put in your life. Every child that God gave to us is not a mistake.
Amen.
That person that God gave to you, God gave them to you for a reason.
Right.
You got to tell them that. There's nothing more powerful than the words that comes out of your mouth. Mm. Well, the Bible says the power of life and death is in your tongue. You can speak life to that person. Oh, God help us today. You can speak life to that person, and that person's life can come alive. You never know how many people are just thinking about committing suicide just in this room today.
Come on.
Because they thought the life was not the way it's supposed to become.
Mm.
Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So I challenge you as a church. I challenge you to show the love of Jesus Christ. Person that done you wrong, you got to start with them. Man, I love you. I grew up in life, and I won't give you my whole testimony, but I grew up being abused. So all of a sudden one day on television, I forgave a person years ago, but then I turn on television and I see the joke on TV. So I call him the N-word. I cussed him out. I start hitting the walls. I forgot to tell you, I was a pastor at the time. Because I thought it was all out of me. But it wasn't. And so the Lord says, you're doing and you're acting this way because you hadn't forgiven that person. Mm. So I asked God to forgive me for not forgiving the person. 2 weeks later, found on the side of the road dead, that person. What if I would have took that to the grave? Some of y'all got some stuff you got to get over with right now, because you're holding on to stuff that somebody made you mad, and you just holding on because I'm just mad with them. You better get over that. There are people would love to go back to their loved ones and just tell them one more thing. If I could just hear that voice, whew. Look, I watched my oldest brother drown right in front of me. I mean, just go underwater, and only to find out that he was stuck right under the place where I was standing on the dock. Carrying guilt around, mad with God, the only one that can do something about it. Can I tell you what I did? I spent years of this person with everybody liking me on the outside, but on the inside, I was miserable, man. I think Michael Jackson wrote a song, the great Michael Jackson, the great biblical poet, who said, he said, I'm talking about the man in the mirror. Yeah, you got to get some things right with the man in the mirror. Because if you don't get it right with the man in the mirror, you're living a lie. And some of y'all love people and you love them, but you just won't let that word come out of your mouth. So you're hesitating and you're pausing in life. You can't get to where you go. And so you get to a certain point and then you self-sabotage yourself because you don't understand that you're supposed to be there. God says today that stuff's going to end today. It's going to end today. It's going to end today because you're going to be a big boy. You're going to be a big girl. You're going to put your big boy, big girl drawers on. Can I say drawers in church? You're going to put them on today. You're going to put them on today, and you're going to do the right thing. Hallelujah, somebody. Glory to God. Thank y'all so much. Thank y'all so much. Everybody pray.
Amen.
Glory to God. Father, we thank you. Today, God, we love you and we adore you. We spent some valuable time here today, oh God. Time that was needed, time to work on ourselves. We laughed about some things, God. We cried about some things. But, God, in reality, we got to get some things right. So, Father, we can't walk around with a false face on anymore, allowing ourselves to look like the person that we want to be but never becoming that person. Father, I thank you. And I bless you, Lord, for everyone who's here today. For every marriage today, I pray that that marriage would be made whole. For every relationship that has been broken between the child and the parent, because the child can't stand the parent, because they don't think the parent is doing right. And parent is looking at the child saying, it wouldn't be this way if you weren't in my life. God, help us all today, oh God. Help us today, oh God. We bind the devil right now in the name of Jesus. I speak wholeness in this place. I speak life in this place. Hallelujah. Men shall go back to telling their boys how much they love them. Women shall go back to telling their daughters how much you love them, God. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Jesus. Don't you allow your abuse in your life to predict what your future is going to be. We bind every addiction today in the name of Jesus. Whether it's alcohol addiction, it has to come subject to the word of God. Whether it's a smoking addiction, it has to come subject to the word of God. Whether it's a pornographic addiction, it has to come subject to the Lord. Hallelujah, God. Whatever the addiction is today, it has to become subject unto the Lord. Today, Father, we come and we ask that you don't allow us to just rend our garments, rend our heart, oh God. Purify our hearts today in the name of Jesus. That man and that woman will love each other for them, oh God. In the name of Jesus. I thank you, oh God. I pray for those who are thinking about tipping out on their marriage. God says, I'm going to catch you in the act. Hallelujah. Turn them around right now. Turn them around right now, God, in the name of Jesus. You won't cheat on your spouse. The devil is a liar. You won't do it. Hallelujah. We're stopping you right now in the name of Jesus. Your body won't function like it's supposed to function. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Change the mind, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. That person who's got those pills at home, you've been thinking about it once you get back home. God says, pour them out today. Pour them out in the name of Jesus. Pour them out in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Those of you who are deciding to go into the way of God, God says, you don't need that marijuana. You don't need that cocaine. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God says, all you need is me. Hallelujah. He says, give up. Give up today. Hallelujah. If you honor what I'm about to say right now, God says, I will deliver you today. You take that alcohol and you pour it out when you get home. In the name of Jesus. I don't care how much it costs you. Don't pass it on to nobody. If you take all that weed and you just pour it down the toilet today. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. If you take those cigarettes and ball them up today and put them out today. God says, I will deliver you today in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'll deliver you today. I'll deliver you today. I'll deliver you today. I'll deliver you today, God says. In the name of Jesus. God says, if you get that relationship right with me, hallelujah, I'll make sure that everybody around you, glory to God, will know the love that you're supposed to produce out of your life. So, Father, we thank you today. Hallelujah, God. We pray today, oh God. Thank you, God, as you call all of us to be intercessors, oh God. We intercede for that person right now. Don't listen to the devil. Don't listen to him. Don't listen to him. Don't listen to him talking about you don't know what they're saying. You don't know what they're doing when I get home. God said, don't listen to them. When you get home, things can be changed by the time you get there. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Don't listen to that voice that's speaking negative to you right now. Hallelujah. How do I know? Because he used to speak to me also. But God is a God who is able to go in and work from the inside out. Father, we thank you right now. For this is a day of deliverance, oh God. A day of sharing our love. A day of speaking words of love and of comfort. So that we can all get it together, oh God. Father, I thank you because you said no fear. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. And for those of you who are here today, and that fear is in your life today, whether you have the fear of death, glory to God. God says you won't even start living until you understand that you don't have to fear death. So you don't have to fear that. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Those who have any kind of fear that's going on, God, there's no fear to you today. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. He says, my blood still works. My power is still alive. Hallelujah. If you avail yourself to me, God says, hallelujah. If you come to me, I'll come to you. Hallelujah. He says, my power still works in the name of Jesus. And so we thank you right now. We pull down every stronghold right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That person who's cutting themselves. The devil is a liar. Glory to God. You cutting yourself. God says, no, no, no. You don't have to shed your blood. I've shed my blood for you already. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, so we thank you. And we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Listen, one more thing Pastor Kid's got to say. But I want to share this last thing. Lord, begin to speak to me. He says, you got to make everything spiritual. He said, we got too many people walking in the natural right now. Because you see stuff in the natural. You experience stuff in the natural. And so you approach it from a natural perspective. God says, you got to see spiritual. Everything is spiritual. Your home is spiritual. Your finances are spiritual. Your healing is, everything is spiritual. So if you, oh my God, help us here today. If you see it like God sees it, God didn't see from a perspective of the human flesh. It's an enemy with God. God says, the Bible talks about how the man of God, and he went to consult somebody else before he consulted God. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, he had a sickness in his body. And he went and he sought the physician before he sought God. And God got upset and he ended up killing him. Lost everything. You can't. Oh, God said, we consulting the wrong people. Yeah. The scripture says in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God. If I seek his kingdom first, then he says all this other stuff is going to be added unto you. I don't know what you need added to your life today, but God said if you turn off your natural vision and you start sinning from a spiritual perspective, you're going to see the hand of God move in your life. Thank y'all so much. Thank y'all so much. Thank y'all so much. Thank y'all so much. And thank y'all so much. Look, I love every last one of y'all. Every last one of y'all. I love all y'all too. I love all y'all too. I love you too, Deacon Mills. I love you too, man. And I love...
All right, come on, give the man of God a hand. Hasn't this been amazing this whole month of Wednesdays and Sundays? I'm going to ask Mother Rankin to come at this time. She has something for us, the flyer. Really quick, just about two more minutes. We have one for her. Y'all here on April 8th, there is a big thing that's happening April 8th. Do y'all know what it is? It's Bishop's 55th birthday. So don't leave. She's going to tell us something really quick. We want to honor the man of God, and this is the perfect time. We have some information for you, and she and Deacon Rankin have been asked to take the helm to help us guide through Bishop's 55th birthday.
Amen. April the 8th is our bishop and our pastor's birthday, his 55th. So we want to make this the best birthday for him. He's not a person that likes to be put on display. We don't do pastors' anniversaries and that type of things. He doesn't like to do that. He likes to give back to his church, his members, people that he preaches and prays for every day. Now, many of you, or some of us, will call Pastor. Pastor, I need so-and-so. Pastor, can I do so-and-so? Pastor, My door locked. My son's not acting right. My husband's not acting. All of these many times. And you don't ever look at the clock. I'm just saying. But this is a time to show your appreciation to him for his sacrifice. Now, he doesn't like to do this, but the Bible tells us that when we bless the man of God, God will pour out his blessings on you. Amen. So it's not a time to hold back, and it's not a time to look at your pocket and say, well, because Pastor didn't look at the clock when he got up and came to your house. Okay, I'm just being real here. Okay. So